Hi, I'm Jonathan Weiner. I'm chief engineer of MWorks Mastering Studios, director of education for iZotope, and also associate professor of music production and engineering at Berklee College of Music. And welcome to Mastering Month. This week, during Mastering Month, I'm going to be talking to you about the art and science of mastering. I'm going to give you some context and understanding about the history of mastering. I'm going to tell you a little bit about where it's come from, and therefore I think you'll understand better how to do it. And you'll also understand maybe why it's different from mixing. Ultimately, I think this will help you do a better job mastering yourself. Mastering is important for a whole bunch of reasons. One of the things that mastering gives you is a chance to stop thinking about mixing and start thinking about what your mix is going to sound like to the consumer. When you're mixing, you're taking all of the different tracks you've recorded and putting them together to sound like a single thing, a song. In mastering, we're getting that song already mixed together, so we've only got the stereo file, the two tracks put together. So when you're mixing, you're thinking about, you know, how can I get the tambourine to sound just right, or how can I make the bagpipe sit properly, or, you know, whatever the instruments are, you're trying to get each one to sound just right in the mix and really focusing on the individual players in the play, if you will. In mastering, we're really stepped back and looking at the big picture and thinking about adjusting overall tone, still thinking about how the pieces are fitting together, but we're looking at the whole mix as a whole piece. We can't really remix a track. We can make helpful small adjustments to it, but we can't really completely redo the track. We can't change the tempo of a track. We can't change the key of a track. These are things that are usually part of the mixing process and not the mastering process. At the heart of the mastering discipline are a couple of simple things that you can do. For instance, always listen to your original mix at a level that's matched with your mastered version. You might do things when you're mastering that increase the level on a meter and increase the sound coming out of the speakers. You need to make an adjustment so that when you listen to the before and after, you're actually comparing them in a way that's level matched. Because at the end of the day, whether we make a track louder or not, we also want to make sure that we're making it better. And the only way that you can tell that it's better is by referring back to your original track while you're doing your work. So it's important as a mastering engineer that you have a good reference material. The reference material should be other records that sound like the kind of record that you're making and also that is a good example of that. So it's important not only to listen before and after to your track and the finished result, but also to compare it to something else that's in that same domain. One of the things I recommend is that you just take some time after you're done mixing. If you can, step away for a couple of days and go back and listen to your mix. Using reference materials can certainly help because then you have some external point of reference where you're not just in your own environment of being the composer and the mixer and now the mastering engineer. Something else you can do is listen to your mixes in different environments. That's probably something that people do when they're mixing to get a different perspective. It's also helpful as a mastering engineer just so you understand what the problems might be that you need to address in mastering. So all of those things can help you get a little bit of perspective on mastering your own mixes.